Hello friends, a warm welcome to you at the Kiran Nadar Museum of Art this afternoon. We are delighted on two counts today. Firstly, a talk by Kavita Singh, which is always something one is looking forward to because it's never ever short of being memorable, anything but memorable. In fact, the reputation of her talks precedes her for being engaging and riveting with her animated way of presenting fresh insights that she always brings into a well-researched subject area. Dr. Kavita Singh, as all of you may know, is the Dean at the School of Art and Aesthetics at JNU. She has recently been awarded the Infosys Prize 2018 for her excellent contribution for the humanities. Very happy to have you here today, Kavita. Secondly, this is our first collaboration with the Shalini Passi Foundation, established by Shalini Passi, a Delhi-based art collector, involved with FICA as a patron, who sits on the advisory board of COJ, who's a patron of Kochi Muziris Biennale, and who's deeply invested in the foundation and through foundation is promoting various forms of art practices, sponsors younger artists, sustains their projects across artistic disciplines. Thank you, Shalini. We're delighted to partner with you on this one. Dr. Arshia Lokhandwala is an art historian, curator, former founding director, and curator of Lakirin Gallery, Mumbai. She now curates the Passi Foundation, and we have associated with you earlier many times. A warm welcome to you as well. And I'm sure all of you are waiting to hear what Kavita has to present. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Arshia. Hi, everyone. It gives me great pleasure today to welcome you here for the first lecture from the Shalini Passi Art Foundation's lecture series. We are delighted to be presenting the talk in collaboration with the Kiran Nadar Museum of Art. Thank you, KNMA, for hosting us here. Before we begin, may I invite the founder, Shalini Passi, to say a few words.
As you may know, I started my foundation earlier this year to nurture the interest of creative collectors, curators, and develop a new paradigm for the arts in India. We at the foundation feel it is important to embrace our rich cultural heritage and use this to inspire a new generation of artists in the country. It is therefore fitting that we are holding this event at KNMA, where Mrs. Nadar's collection extends from India's most established artists to some of the most cutting-edge work in South Asia today. Today, we are very privileged to have with us Professor Kavita Singh speaking on the Congress of Kings, a painting by Muhammad Shah Rangila. She serves as a professor of art history and is currently serving as a dean of the School of Art and Aesthetics at JNU in New Delhi. She is also the 2018 recipient of the Infosys Prize for Humanities. Congratulations again, Kavita, on this prestigious award.
Thank you very much indeed. I can't tell you how happy I am to be here today and how happy I am to see all of you. This afternoon also brings back bittersweet memories of the moment when I began working on the talk that I'll be sharing with you today, because it's my engagement with this particular painting that I'll be discussing actually began for a workshop that we held at JNU in conjunction with the visit of a wonderful scholar called Natalie Campin, who came to us to teach a course on gender and sexuality in Roman art, at which time my colleagues organized a conference called The Architectures of Erotica, and I had my first foray into looking at this painting. Since then, more recently, I've re-engaged with it and developed a more fully fleshed out paper. I've presented it at a few academic fora in the US, and I was keen on sharing it also with a Delhi audience. And unfortunately, in the years that have passed, Natalie Campin is no longer with us on this earth, which is something that is a matter of regret for a lot of us who are present in this room. But also my own university, where I presented the first draft of this, doesn't see to be the right venue for this talk. So I've hesitated to suggest giving this talk over there. imagine my delight then when I get a phone call from Arshia Lokhandwala, who tells me, Kavita, I've just been appointed the curator of the Shalini Passi Art Foundation. We want you to give a talk in Delhi, and we want you to talk about an erotic theme. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much for, okay, thank you, ladies. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity of sharing this paper in my city with my friends and with all, you know, old and new. I'm very, very grateful for this opportunity. My thanks to Shalini Passi and Arshia Lokhandwala and everybody who works in your foundation, who has worked away at this. And my deep thanks and gratitude and appreciation to the Kiran Nadar Museum of Art and to Rubina Karode, to whom every time I come to see an exhibition over here, I end up writing an email of thanks for what this museum is bringing to us as an art audience in Delhi. We are really grateful to have this institution and this institution in our city, so my heartfelt thanks. Now, the focus of this talk is a large-sized miniature painting from the late Mughal period. And it's a painting which is usually published with the title Muhammad Shah Making Love. But for reasons that should become clear in the course of this talk, I prefer to call it Muhammad Shah in Sexual Congress. The painting is signed in golden letters at the bottom margin by the leading artist of Muhammad Shah's atelier, Chitirman, who in this inscription says that this painting is the work of the house-born or the Khanazad Chitirman, which means that he was born into a family of artists that was already in service in the imperial court. So in this inscription, Chitirman seems to be taking pride in his status as at least a second-generation imperial artist. And he also seems to be taking pride in this picture that he has produced. And he has good reason to be proud of this picture because he has produced something very beautiful. It's a finely rendered, beautifully composed work of art, which is an excellent example of the high quality that is achieved by some artists in the time of Muhammad Shah, the Mughal emperor who occupied the throne of Delhi from 1719 to 1748. But the aesthetic qualities of this painting are actually overshadowed by the extraordinariness of its theme, because the painting shows Abul Muzaffar Roshan Akhtar Nasiruddin Muhammad Shah Sahib Kirani Sani Padshah Ghazi, the 18th Mughal Emperor of India, engaged in the act of sexual congress with a woman. And the frankness and the clarity of the depiction of the sexual act, the central position that is given to the emperor's member, have excited the attention of scholars who have sought an explanation for the existence of such an image. Why would such a private act be made so publicly visible? To be fair, there are some historians who are not at all puzzled by this image, because for a number of historians who have studied the reign of Muhammad Shah, it is entirely in the fitness of things that a ruler like this would have commissioned a painting like this. Because for them, Muhammad Shah exemplifies the qualities of the late Mughals, who are the rulers who occupied the Mughal throne through the 18th and the 19th century, and who are contrasted in the historiography with the preceding era, which is known as the time of the great Mughals. So the first six Mughal emperors, Babur, Humayun, Akbar, Jahangir, Shah Jahan, Aurangzeb, whose reigns extend over most of the 16th and the 17th centuries, are the greats of Mughal history. In contrast, they are the rulers who expanded their territories into a vast empire. They governed efficiently. Several of them were religiously liberal. They had cosmopolitan interests, and they were generous patrons of the arts. But what was built up by the greats, we are told, was dissipated by the lates, who are characterized as only attending to their own pleasures, while the empire around them crumbled to dust. Here, among the late Mughals, Muhammad Shah actually occupies a central place. His 29-year reign is marked by his extreme incompetence in matters political, military, and diplomatic. And it is his ineptitude that actually led to the humiliating and devastating invasion by Nadir Shah of Iran, And at the same time, Muhammad Shah also managed to alienate most of his own powerful noblemen and allies, who then broke away from the Mughal Imperium, setting up their independent fiefdoms in places like Lucknow and Hyderabad, causing the Mughal Empire to completely disintegrate. So it's not surprising then that Muhammad Shah has been judged harshly by many historians who think that his political incompetence was matched only by his debauchery. To these historians, a painting like this is totally symptomatic of his character, which, in the words of one critic, is only depicting the sex-obsessed mentality of the debauched Muhammad Shah. This was Karl Khandalwala. Now, it's generally agreed that Muhammad Shah was dedicated to the pursuit of pleasure. He seems to make a declaration of this himself in the sobriquet that he adopts, because he calls himself Muhammad Shah Rangila. And Rangila literally means the colorful, but idiomatically, Rangila has the sense of being pleasure-loving. And Muhammad Shah is meant to have been a connoisseur of beautiful women and lovely boys. But he was also a very keen patron of music and dance and literature and art. And we see him here listening to music, and musicologists tell us that it was at his court that the genre of khayal was developed. And this is the genre that dominates classical music of northern India today. Muhammad Shah was himself a poet. He supported a number of important poets at his court. He patronized poetry in several languages, including Persian and Urdu and Braj Bhasha. And under his patronage, the art of painting that had all but lapsed at the Mughal court actually enjoyed a stunning revival. And scholars have identified a growing corpus of paintings that were produced under his patronage. Some of these paintings are very easy to ascribe to his reign, as they depict Muhammad Shah, like this scene, which is set in a palace, showing him talking to some of his high noblemen, or this one, which I really love, which is a very lightly tinted drawing, showing him inside a garden. But Muhammad Shah's artists also produced other works that don't show the emperor, such as, probably, this very lovely scene of women playing with fireworks on a terrace set inside the palace harem. Now, while political historians have disparaged Muhammad Shah, in recent years, it is the cultural historians who work on the history of music and dance and painting and poetry who have looked upon Muhammad Shah with more favor, and they have seen our painting with more sympathetic eyes. And in a recent publication, this representation of the emperor in flagrante delicto has most recently then been called a, and I quote here, a purely symbolic image intended to illustrate the emperor's virility and power, close quotes. So for one set of critics who don't like Muhammad Shah, this painting is a snapshot that catches him engaged in the act of sex, and it demonstrates his debauchery. For the other group that likes Muhammad Shah, it doesn't show an act of sex. It only shows political assertion through the metaphor of sex. Now, this is an interpretation that allows them to recuperate the emperor's character. He's not such a bad sort after all. So these two kinds of commentators have different assessments about Muhammad Shah as a king who was terrible or as a king who was not so bad. But both sorts of commentators seem to concur that had this been an actual literal depiction of a sex act by a Mughal emperor, that would be a bad thing. And the scholars who defend Muhammad Shah do so by arguing that this depiction of him having sex is actually a depiction of something else. As a Mughal emperor, Muhammad Shah tends to be examined through an Islamicist lens. And it becomes interesting then to see how scholars and art historians interpret paintings of Hindu Rajput kings who are also shown engaged in sexual activity. And there are many such paintings. And we see that scholars tend to use very different terms for their analyses of those paintings. So for instance, when the scholar Andrew Topsfield discusses a painting that shows Maharana Amar Singh II of Udaipur making love in a garden, he tells us that the ruler here is being depicted as the poetic essence of Shringar Ras. And by invoking the concept of ras, he's placing this ruler's action within a Sanskrit theory of aesthetics, where rasas are the sentiments or the feelings that are invoked in us by the experience of beauty. The Shringar ras is the aesthetic apperception that arises in us when we see artworks or representations that are concerned with love. And so placing this portrait of Amar Singh in the context of rasa removes the image from Amar Singh's bodily experience, and it removes it from the specific historical and biographical context of the ruler and his life, and it locates it in a realm of ineffable essences that are being shared by an aesthetic community. The poem that is at the top of this painting of Amar Singh in the garden actually describes a setting in which the spring breezes and the scent of flowers and the smell of sandalwood paste and the strains of the sarang rag, which is being sung on the side, all conspire to evoke the erotic sentiment. So it makes sense for a scholar to place this scene showing an individual ruler within a diffuse aesthetic sentiment. But even this drawing of an erotic fantasy that shows Maharao Ram Singh of Kota pleasuring three women simultaneously, one with his penis and one with each of his hands, when it was published recently, was placed in the framework of Raj Dharm, or the king's obligations to experience all the Purusharths, including calm or sensual pleasure. Now, we should note that in this fragment, we only have a partial view of the hardworking Maharaja discharging his obligations, because there would have been two more women associated with his feet, which are missing because the drawing is torn. But we know this because we see a very similar configuration in other paintings, like this one, where a later ruler from the same Rajput kingdom is shown with five women. I hope you can see it in the detail. I've numbered the women for your convenience. There are five women, one on each of his hands, one on each of his feet, and one on his penis. And this is at the heart of an absolutely extraordinary painting, which I think shows sexual joy being experienced simultaneously by humans and by beasts. Now, regardless of how graphic they are, paintings of Rajput rulers in sexual congress are understood to spring from a milieu where karma, or the erogenous drive, is a purusharth. It's one of the central aims of life, which is prescribed by Indic religious texts, and where a king is believed to be born with an exceptionally high karmic balance, and he has a duty to expend it by engaging in personal pleasure through what is called Raj Krida, or royal pleasure play. Thus, the acts that are depicted in Rajput paintings are seen less as the personal pleasures of the individual king and more like their participation in a timeless, civilizational, quasi-mystical ideal, almost as though their scenes of love play were in some way direct descendants of the well-known erotic sculptures on Indian temples that were made some 700 or 800 years before the paintings were produced. But the painting of Muhammad Shah is allowed to partake of none of these civilizational essences, and it only is seen to relate to the life and character of this particular king. In following these lines of analysis, most scholars of Indian painting are consciously or unconsciously following a template that was laid down 100 years ago by the great art historian Ananda Kumar Swami. In 1916, Kumar Swami published his magnum opus, a two-volume tome titled Rajput Painting. And through it, Kumar Swami introduced the world to a category of Indian art that he had just discovered: miniature paintings made between the 17th and the 19th centuries for North Indian kingdoms that were ruled by the Hindu Rajput dynasties, rather than the better known paintings made for the Muslim Mughals. But if Kumar Swami discovered Rajput painting by scouring junk shops and dealerships and then suddenly realizing that the paintings that he had purchased belonged to a tradition that had not yet been discovered, had not yet been named, then he also invented Rajput painting, because he produced an ersatz tradition for them. And Kumar Swami characterized Rajput painting as having not just a Hindu essence, but that this essence underlay Hindu culture at large and had remained unchanged till contemporary times. In the polemical introduction that Kumar Swami wrote to these volumes, he asserted that Mughal and Rajput paintings were entirely unlike each other in their inspiration, in their aesthetic intention, and in their connection with or their disconnect from the wellsprings of Indian civilization. And in these extracts that are taken from his introduction to these volumes, Kumar Swami tells us that Mughal art is secular, intent upon the present moment, and worldly, while Rajput painting is essentially a mystic expression of the Hindu view of life. Today's scholarship on Indian painting has done much to erode the boundary that Kumar Swami had erected between Mughal and Rajput painting. We are well aware of how Mughal and Rajput spheres were actually deeply enmeshed with each other, whether they were connected through love or war, through marriage and family ties, or through enmity and conflict. These worlds were never politically, economically, or even genetically separated from each other. And we are acutely aware of the interconnection of Mughal and Rajput worlds, particularly through the family ties of Rajput princesses who married into the Mughal imperial family and whose sons became the Mughal emperors in succeeding generations. We are aware of the role of Rajput rulers, who were the military generals and the administrators for the Mughal Empire, and we are aware of the deep interconnections between Mughal and Rajput painting with the frequent traveling of artists and artworks between the Mughal and the Rajput courts. And yet, even though we know that Mughal and Rajput cultural spheres all stood under the same sheltering skies, our interpretive horizons, alas, have remained quite narrowly confined. And so we have the highly polarized interpretations that I have just described, in which, for instance, the depiction of Rajput patrons having sex is always seen as the depiction of something other than or something more than sex, whereas in Mughal paintings, the depiction of sex is only sex. That both kinds of interpretations, biographical and metaphorical, might apply to both kinds of paintings is very seldom acknowledged. And so today, by closely examining the painting of Muhammad Shah in Congress, I hope to suggest some different points of entry that will open out a range of meanings for this image, meanings that are both documentary and symbolic, biographical and metaphorical, filled with history and with Russ. Let's first look for precedents for a painting like the one we are considering today within the canon of imperial Mughal art. Most Mughal imperial portraits are formal, and they show the emperor either discharging his official duties, as we see in the Pachanama painting on the left, where we see Shah Jahan in his darbar, or a painting offers a kind of virtual substitute for the emperor's presence, like in the painting we're seeing on the right, which is supposed to be Nur Jahan holding an image of her deceased husband. Paintings that show private moments, ones in which recognizable members of the imperial family are shown engaged in intimacy, are much fewer in number. But some such paintings do exist. And I've gathered here on this slide one handful of such images, most of which show princes with their unnamed partners. But in one case, and we'll return to this image later, at the top middle, we also see a reigning emperor, Jahangir, playfully embracing a beloved. Now, as we can see when we look at these paintings, the sense of physical love between the couple is addressed very discreetly. And it's sensed by us through a shared cup of wine or a shared couch, through interlocked gazes and through half embraces. The bodies that shine through the fine muslin, the shirts that are open, more often than not belong to men, and they seem to invite caress. There are hands that gesture towards, but they don't quite touch the partner's sexual organs. In this sequence of restrained royal lovers, then, the depiction of Muhammad Shah indeed appears unique, because on a low bed, the emperor is shown mounting a woman. They're both dressed, or nearly dressed, but their clothes are just displaced enough for the sexual organs to do their business. He wears his turban and his long shirt, But his pajamas have been removed so that we can see the heavy testicles and his enormous penis, just the tip of which dips into her vulval fold. Her salwar is lowered. Her upper garment or her peshwas is open so that her little breasts can show. But there is stasis despite the activity. And even the necklaces between her breasts have not moved out of place. The couple occupy the central register of a page that is nearly square in format. And most of the color in this painting seems to have leached into the uppermost register, which is dominated by a brilliant red awning and a green and gold rolled up blind. There are color notes also in the lowermost register of this painting, where the red-bordered garden has a sprinkling of flowers of many hues. The central register with the two lovers and their two attendants, in comparison, is rendered mostly in white and in shades of gray. An air of calm pervades the painting. And the calm comes, I think, from the cool, unornamented zone of whites and grays, and also from the painting's strong horizontals and the strict symmetry that we see here. But the calm also comes from the fact that the figures are not really engaged with each other. Their gazes do not meet, and we are able to see the sexual organs so well precisely because the figures are doing so little with them. His hands are below, not on her breasts. His penis is not sunken into her. It is almost entirely visible. It is put on display. Rather than an act of passion, then, this is some kind of show. This is something that was astutely noted by Vishakha Desai, the first scholar to observe the symbolic aspects of this painting. And she called this an image of stately grandeur. And as she pointed out, Muhammad Shah is shown here primarily as a king, not a man. His portrait is embellished with the accoutrements of kingship, such as the sword and the hookah, which are prominently placed near the bed. The two attendants who stand at the ready with a morchal and a whisk, and perhaps more significantly, by the halo of gold paint that encircles his royal head. Now, this golden nimbus was first used in Mughal painting in Jahangir's reign. And while some scholars credit the arrival of this halo to the influence of European Catholic imagery that traveled to the Mughal court in the 16th century via European prints, the halo was actually only a means of rendering visible a theory of illumined kingship that had already been expounded at great length by Abul Fazl, who was the biographer of Akbar. In Abul Fazl's conception, Akbar was a vessel for far, the divine light that is conferred on kings. Akbar's artists didn't show him with a halo, but the artists who worked for his son Jahangir, whom we see on the right, adopted this visual convention. And yet in Jahangir's time, when we start seeing this kingly illumination being visibly rendered through the halo, there seems to be a system at work that governs its appearance. Because the emperor's portrait seems to don its halo only at official or public appearances, and to take it off or to doff it in more intimate settings. And so as we see here on the left, in this intimate portrait of Jahangir with his beloved, he's shown without his halo. And in the allegorical painting on the right-hand side of a mighty Jahangir embracing a puny Shah Abbas of Iran, Jahangir's halo becomes an enormous sunburst. His successor, Shah Jahan, in contrast, was almost always shown with a halo of greater or lesser luminosity, as in this equestrian portrait and then in this charming portrait of him sitting on a platform with his little son, both of them playing with jewels. Muhammad Shah's nimbus seems to make less predictable appearances, as we can see in these two paintings of very similar occasions when he meets a small number of high-ranking courtiers. Muhammad Shah has a halo in the outdoor scene on the right, but not in the indoor one on the left. So the presence of the halo then in this painting makes the image a formal one, in which we are supposed to be reminded of the emperor's quasi-divine status. Along with the halo, the painting also contains some other elements which align it with what is in fact the most formal genre of the Mughal portrait, the Jharuka Darshan image. The Jharoka Darshan was a ritual in which the Mughal ruler appeared at the window of his palace twice a day in front of his subjects at sunrise and at sunset. And the appearance of the emperor in connection with the movement of the sun was meant to underline his connection with the life-giving light of the sun. And it gave his subjects an opportunity to have a darshan, which is a ritualized and an almost worshipful viewing of the king as a quasi-divine being. There are descriptive show this ceremony of Jharoka Darshan by showing the ruler appearing at a window. But it's actually more common in Mughal painting to find diminutive Jharoka portraits that show just the bust of a ruler framed by a window. These are iconic images, and in their own time, the Jharoka portraits probably served as portable substitutes for the king himself. People who were traveling, who were unable to go and perform their obeisance to the king twice a day, would have probably paid their respects to these little paintings instead. In the abbreviated view of the small Jharoka Darshan portraits, the window setting of the scene is indicated by the tight architectural frame that is there around the ruler's bust portrait. Note how there's always a carpet draped over the balustrade, so that when the emperor leans on it or he touches it, he will not touch hard or cold stone. And above his head, almost always, you see the rolled up blind depicted, which reinforces our impression of this being a window frame. Now notice how in this painting too, there is a rolled up blind above Muhammad Shah and a carpet of flowers laid at his feet. A prominent architectural frame surrounds him. And even the deep gray recess echoes Muhammad Shah's best known Jharoka Darshan image, which we see on the left here. And so we know that this is a scene that is meant to be seen, fit for darshan as it were, as is suggested by the presence of the two flanking attendants who act as focalizers, turning our gazes back from the edges to the center of the painting, urging us to join these people in witnessing the scene that is unfolding there. What of the woman with whom Muhammad Shah is engaged? There is a curious tenderness in the painting. There is the suggestion of a relationship in the way she rests her hand on his shoulder. And if he has a golden halo around his head, then the artist makes sure that gold also pools around her head through the brocade pillow on which she rests. Now, Vishakha Desai had suggested that Muhammad Shah's sexual partner in this painting might be Koki, who was a courtesan, who was known to be very important to the emperor, and who exerted a lot of influence over him. But naming the woman thus would turn the painting into the record of a particular relationship rather than a generalized act of sex. Can this be Koki? The painting itself doesn't name her. In that, it doesn't differentiate her face from the faces of the two attendants who flanked the couple. Muhammad Shah's portrait, on the other hand, is highly individualized. And so this difference that we see between the portraiture of males, which strives to capture individual likenesses, and of females, where entire crowds of women might be different versions of the same idealized beauty, is something that is actually very common in Mughal painting. We see it here in this painting from the Parchanama, where the noblemen and the princes and the emperor are carefully depicted with individual features, but the women entertainers at the bottom are all from the same cookie cutter. Rather than mimetic portraiture, paintings tended to differentiate women through their dress and their ornament, which would suggest differences in their rank. But in our painting, the ornaments that are worn by the two women attendants match those of the woman in the center, bead for bead and bangle for bangle. And so I don't believe that this painting can be the record of a relationship between particular lovers because the woman is interchangeable with the other maids. Rather, it is the record of Muhammad Shah's capabilities as a lover. Now, this won't be the only time that Muhammad Shah is cast as a lover in a cultural product from his reign. I had mentioned earlier that the genre of khayal was perfected in his court. Credit for this is usually given to his chief musician, Sadarang, and in a number of khayals that are composed by Sadarang, Muhammad Shah appears as the lover, as the balamua, the beloved, or as the sajan, or the dear one. Volume badha sakte? Many of Sadarang's compositions are still sung today by classical musicians in North India. And in a Braj Bhasha composition by Sadarang that is still quite popular, we hear a lover complaining that Muhammad Shah's absence has robbed the monsoon of its joys. So she's saying, Muhammad Shah Rangile Re, Tum Bin Meko Kari Badiriya Nit Na Suhai. Without you, Muhammad Shah, my colorful lover, it's impossible for me to enjoy the thunderclouds. Umad Ghumad Aave, Naina Jhari Lagave Tarsave. The rolling clouds, the drops that fall, just make my eyes thirsty for the sight of you. Sada Rangile Ko Dukh Daave, Chamak Bijuri Darave. Sada Rang says, your absence gives me pain because without you here, I fear the clouds and the lightning flashes. So the words of Sadarang Khayals seem to address all their love and longing towards Muhammad Shah, casting him as the quintessential Nayak, the hero for whom the heroine pines. Placed in the context of the court's musical compositions, then this painting needs to be seen as something that participates in those age-old Indic traditions of love, much like any painting from a Rajput court. That narrow strip of dark cloud above the pavilion seems even to suggest a monsoon night. But as we can see, Muhammad Shah is not absent from this scene. Perhaps there's another kind of contemporary poetry from Muhammad Shah's time that would have related even more closely to this scene. This is a genre of Urdu poetry called Rekhti. In this poetry, a male poet adopts a woman's voice to speak of the female experience, particularly the female sexual experience. And for this, he uses the non-elite register of language that is suffused with vernacular Hindi words rather than the more courtly Persian vocabulary. Now, Rekhti today is generally associated with 19th century Lucknow, but an early proponent of this genre was in fact from early 18th century Delhi. His name was Mir Jafar Zatali. Now, Zatali's pen name means babbler, and he was a satirist who was known for his bawdy and biting satires. When he was employed in the entourage of the Prince Kambaksh, one of the sons of Aurangzeb, he wrote a satirical poem, which his patron was not supposed to hear, but in which he congratulated his patron for so mightily buggering a goat that it thought it was being mounted by a tiger. Unsurprisingly, when Kambaksh heard the poem, Zatali lost his job. But when he wrote a poem later that lampooned the Emperor Farukh Siyar, the Mughal emperor who just was prior to Muhammad Shah, the reprisal was more severe and Zatali was beheaded. Among the poems that Zatali has left behind for us are the Munazara Ek Keer Vakus, or the dialogue of the penis and the vagina. In this poem, the two organs are arguing with each other to establish their superiority. Oh, vagina, the penis says, there's no pride in being you. If I'm not present, you're useless. And you are like a shell without a pearl. In fact, you're like a wound, dark and deep. I am a tall tree in the garden of love, standing on a single leg with my head high in the air. To this lofty declaration, the vagina replies, oh, penis, don't be proud. It's true that you're long and wide, but you don't know the weaknesses you have. If you vomit, you lose your strength, and you become ashamed of your own incapability. But for me, there is no tiredness. Now, surely poems of this kind were being recited and sung for Muhammad Shah. There was a young nobleman from Hyderabad who visited Delhi in the 1740s during Muhammad Shah's reign, and he left behind a fascinating account of the city in a book called The Murakka-e-Dehli, or an album of Delhi. And in this book, the author, Dargah Kuli Khan, gives us an account of the shrines and the holy men of Delhi, but also of the city's celebrated singers and dancing girls. And he particularly makes note that there was one called Kamal Bai, who was a favorite singer of Muhammad Shah's, who specialized in Sadarang compositions dedicated to the emperor, but was also known for her ribaldry. And so clearly, you can imagine singers moving quickly between refined verses in ornate Persian, Braj Bhasha poems of love and longing, and earthy jokes like the one we just heard in the vernacular. There is a visual and intellectual repertoire to which I'm guessing that the painting is most likely not indebted, and that is the Koka Shastra, or the sex manual tradition. There is a hoary tradition of such texts in Sanskrit, which follows the literary convention of describing different kinds of women and men, and then listing all the different permutations and combinations of the kinds of encounters that can take place between them. While Sanskrit and vernacular versions of such texts would also have been available at court, we also know that this knowledge was circulating in Persianate India through a text called the Lazzatul Nisa, or the Enjoyment of Women, which is a redaction of two Sanskrit sex manuals, the Anangarang of Kalyanmal and the Rati Rahasya of Koka Pandit. And we can be sure that the Lazzatul Nisa was known in Muhammad Shah's court because a translation in verse was made for him. And this is a later 19th century manuscript of this verse translation that is dedicated to Muhammad Shah, which is now in the British Library and which has these rather prim illustrations. An earlier version of the Lazzatul Nisa was a prose translation which was more widespread in its circulation. This is from the version that is in the Bibliothèque Nationale. In the tradition of the Lazzat, men are categorized by their penis size. And the male with the largest penis is characterized as being, and I quote here, covetous, gluttonous, volatile, lazy. He cares little for the sexual right, except when the spasm approaches, close quotes. In case you're curious, in this text, medium size is the best. It seems to me that it is hardly likely that a sexological tradition that disparages men with large penises would inform a portrait that seems to be exaggerating the length of Muhammad Shah's organ. For a moment, let's also consider the sexual position that is shown in the painting. Most sex manual illustrations show complicated, even acrobatic positions. Presumably, the readers of sex manuals needed help in working out these more complex poses. One such series which shows exotic poses is this, is this very intriguing set which is made by a Mughal migrant artist in Bikaner. And it combines eroticism and exoticism by claiming to show various Mughal rulers and noblemen also engaged in sex acts that are very complicated. The more commonplace approach then, taken by the artist who shows Muhammad Shah and his partner in this painting, these kinds of poses are hardly ever considered worth illustrating for amusement or for instruction. So why does the artist choose to show this rather than a more complex position that would have celebrated Muhammad Shah's sexual athleticism? With the woman's legs raised as though to retain the sperm, this is in fact the position of impregnation rather than sexual experimentation. And I sense that impregnation is implicit through the painting, because even though what it shows seem to record the very beginning of the sexual act, in the fountain and in the spurting foliage that we see, I should have had an image of the whole picture, I apologize. But in the fountain and the spurting foliage that is there in the blind, they seem to anticipate the climax. And visual puns also abound in the variously shaped vessels that are on the floor, the hookah pipe that snakes its way across the mattress, and the very sturdy sword that lies nearby. Now, it's unlikely that a royal formal commission would actually record the actual act or fact of conceiving an heir, because it would have to imply that it was showing a legitimate spouse engaged in a sex act. And with the parda rules, I imagine that this was unthinkable. So I would say that instead of recording a particular event, this painting seems to be recording the general information of Muhammad Shah's virility and fertility, which continued well into his middle age. Why would it be important to even say this? Some years ago, the scholar Terence McInerney wrote a very fine essay on the art of Muhammad Shah's time. And in it, he traced Muhammad Shah's changing appearance as he aged and as he became increasingly corpulent. He also told us that Muhammad Shah had a degenerative disease of his motor reflexes, which degenerated or deteriorated at an early age, affecting his control over his lower body. When he was no longer able to ride a horse in the ordinary way, saddle makers in Lucknow made a special saddle that supported him, so he was still able to ride. But soon he couldn't mount a horse at all, and he had to be carried in a palanquin. Given what we know about Muhammad Shah's deteriorating reflexes, McInerney says, it is difficult to accept Chitterman's painting of the emperor making love at absolute face value. Might this wayward but curiously moving depiction elegize a power that the ailing emperor no longer possessed, McInerney asks. To McInerney's compelling suggestion, I'd like to offer a caveat. The intention of this painting might have been not to elegize a lost capability, indulging in the emperor's nostalgia for days gone by, but to publish the fact that the capability was not lost. As Muhammad Shah became less able to ride or walk, we can presume that there must have been speculation everywhere about whether he had become impotent as well. The painting that we have been considering, I suggest, could have been a means to counter the rumors of his impotence. It was visible evidence that the emperor's virility remained undiminished. If this painting was meant to be proof of Muhammad Shah's virility, it would only serve its purpose if it was convincing and if it was seen. Whether or not the artist drew the act from life, the careful portrayal within the painting of the emperor, the attention to the details of things like jewels and furniture and clothes, persuade us that here is the representation of real things, really seen. Even the pavilion in which the act takes place, I think, is possible to identify. It is probably the tiny Hira Mahal, which is inside Delhi's Red Fort. This garden pavilion has pillars that exactly match the ones that are shown in the painting. Such details would boost the evidentiary value of the painting, making the event that it records all the more plausible as a real event involving real people in real space. But if such a painting offered proof of Muhammad Shah's potency, it would also need to be seen. To whom was this proof offered? To whom was this painting shown? The first circle of viewers were within the world of the painting itself, the figures of the two maids who suggest that this is a witnessable event. But perhaps these figures also stand in for the circle of the women in the zanana who would be well aware of the emperor's continuing sexual powers. And then, of course, the painting would be seen by the painter who made it and by other members of the atelier within which he worked. A painting like this would take weeks, sometimes months, to complete, and it would have been the subject of study and discussion while it was being produced. And perhaps there were sketches of the painting that remained in the atelier that permitted a different kind of circulation, because I'm sure that this composition was remembered by artists who migrated from the Mughal court to see greener pastures in other centers in the decades after Muhammad Shah's death, because here in a manuscript of a love story made by migrant artists from the Mughal court to Murshidabad, we see that same composition being repeated to show the scene of a consummation at a wedding night. In what manner would our painting circulate beyond the atelier? Today, the painting is in the British Library, and it arrived there as part of an enormous cache of manuscripts and albums that were purchased in late 18th century Lucknow by the British agent Richard Johnson. most of the collection that Johnson acquired took the form of albums. And an album, as we know from recent work by many scholars, was a very important kind of book, which was part artifact and part archive. Because in an album, single paintings or pieces of calligraphy, which would get lost or would get damaged on their own, were gathered and preserved. For example, as in this Iranian accordion fold album. Albums would then be kept in the library. They would be taken out. They would be passed around and discussed in mehfils or gatherings, like this little mehfil we see in a charming vignette from a border from an album of Jahangir's time. But our painting seems never to have been mounted in an album. When it arrived in the British Library, it was in a portfolio with other loose sheets, three of which were particularly noted by the librarian who was doing the cataloging as being special because they were, and I quote, drawings, very obscene, should be destroyed for two, close quotes. The clutch of obscene pictures included our painting, of course, but it also had this come hitherish courtesan and a large drawing of an important battle that had occurred in the 1760s, much after Muhammad Shah's death. Here's the courtesan. But what makes this battle scene obscene in the eyes of the librarian is a detail that you won't be able to see at this distance. It's a detail in the lower left where we see victorious soldiers sweeping into the captured town and raping the women in their houses. So if you want to see this later online, the detail is here. This clutch of obscene pictures, including our painting, we are grateful were not destroyed as the librarian had ordered. But the fact that they were never included in an album is suggested also by the crack that runs across the page that this painting is pasted on. Why was it not included in an album? Was it because the painting was not meant to circulate very widely and be seen by many eyes? Or was it kept as a loose leaf because it could be seen by more people and be more easily passed from hand to hand? Perhaps the painting stayed within the harem. Perhaps it was seen by a small group of male courtiers as well. And perhaps these men talked about it to other men and they to others, so that the news of the painting spread to a larger and larger circle of people who had seen the painting, people who had heard about the painting from those who had seen it, and those who had heard about the painting from others who had heard about the painting from others who had seen it. And so that the rumors of this painting, through its relays of information, would then do its work beyond the palace, in the realm of the bazaar, where it would create a counter to the possible rumors of the emperor's impotence, which this painting had to contradict. So the painting stayed within the palace, but it could still conjure images that would travel in people's minds. What an irony this is. Living behind high walls, moving around in marbled rooms, clad in silks and jewels and perfumes, the body of the emperor is the center of 1,000 careful calibrations that are meant to maintain his distance from the common folk. And yet, to keep his hold upon his throne or his pride in his manliness, he needs the common folk to know about the most intimate of his bodily details. 100 years later, these circulating mental images were to produce another iteration of Muhammad Shah in Congress. This curious image that was perhaps made at a Pahari court shows Muhammad Shah sitting stiffly on a dais while a woman squats, legs akimbo, on his lap. The portrait of the emperor is based on Mughal examples that the artist has seen but has not understood, because the profile is recognizably Muhammad Shah's, but the fur collar that he is wearing is part of Mughal winter costume, but here it's draped on the Shah's shoulders and it is unattached to his muslin summer dress. The woman smilingly chucks Muhammad Shah under the chin while he, unaffected, gazes into the distance. Only his penis, springing from a circle of pubic hair, has any connection with her. The sexual motif seems adventitious here, patched onto a conventional portrait of a grandee seated on a terrace. But how different this image of Muhammad Shah in Congress is from the painting that we have been considering so far. Robbed of the symmetrical setting, the witnesses, the halo, the marks of royalty, the visual rhetoric of grandeur. All that this painting does is it tells us that Muhammad Shah had sex. In comparison, we now realize Chitraman had shown us how Muhammad Shah was having sex, but something much more than and something other than sex. Thank you very much for your attention.
It's okay. If I'm good. Yeah, yeah.
Is there any kind of reference to that at all? Or?
I mean, we do know that those kinds of sex manuals circulated and had a readership, but I'm not sure how old the manuscripts that we see, I'm not sure how old those manuscripts are in terms of the illustration that they have. And I don't believe, even though the sex manual tradition was in circulation in the same circle, I don't think that we are mapping onto this painting some of those positions and poses.
Wonderful. And just another question. I just wonder, because you shared the image of the maids, you know,
yeah.
Would we know that these people, the women would be Muslim or they would be Hindu in his court? Or is there any history that speaks about it or addresses it?
There would
it?
Be many different kinds. I mean, you so even know from, let's say, the descriptions of Akbar's harem, they take pride in naming the geographic place of origin of the women in the harem. And so they obviously come from all over India, but you even have these exotic ladies who are Armenians or who come from further north as well. So you do have, let's say, a very multifarious population within the harem. There's a question at
the back. Yeah, there's a question.
Thanks for that, Kavita. I was curious, do we see this tradition follow after Muhammad Shah Rangila? Do we see other subsequent royals doing something similar?
No. The point is that this painting does seem to us like a unique, it's a unique proposition. I'd shown one slide where there was that Bikaner set, which is from the Fitzwilliam Museum in Cambridge. And that is an extraordinary set, which shows or purports to show various Mughal emperors, princes, noblemen, and also, if I'm not mistaken, Portuguese people engaged in very acrobatic acts of sex. Now, those ones, I would say, are connected to, in their position that they show, are connected to the Kamashastric tradition, because the Kamashastric tradition does tend to speak of unusual poses, right? Mm-hmm. But that, it's Keshav, right? Keshav, that set is something that needs to be investigated more carefully. It's a very curious set. It's extremely high quality, and it has profuse inscriptions, like very long, elaborate descriptive inscriptions that this is the portrait of so-and-so. I think the formula is the private pleasures of Badshah Akbar by such and such artist, the private pleasures of Jahangir by such and such artist, the private pleasures of Prince Salim by such and such artist. But those are all, the inscriptions are as much an artifact as the paintings, because the artists whose names those inscriptions are invoking are imperial artists of 100 or 150 years before. So there is actually some sort of satirical intention behind those paintings, right? And the fact that it is being produced in Bikaner, which is a state which is probably at that moment, one has to look into the political history, but probably at that moment is experiencing some amount of freeing of the imperial yoke, would add to it would give the context for a satire of that kind being produced. But it's a set that needs to be investigated. But within the imperial tradition, so I'm going to show something that I'm not supposed to show. Can you turn the slide on? I'll have to see if I have the pictures. There are a couple of things which I don't know enough about. If you can turn the projector on, or I can show you the pictures later. There are a couple of paintings I don't know enough about, so I didn't want to include them. They are, one would say, pornographic. I'll also have to try and remember where I kept them. Yeah, because those are from private collections and I'm not supposed to show them. But I can show them to people without leaving a record behind. So if you see those, you will kind of understand that those are actually for private delectation. They are for people to enjoy in the privacy of their homes. I hope I can find it. Oh, where did I? I'm sorry, I don't remember. Did I put it in downloads? Okay, here's one. I'm showing you one. Okay. So if you see this, I don't know it well enough to be sure whether it's actually Jahangiri or whether it's a very good Lucknow painting. Pretending to be Jahangiri, as we have, you may know, some of you here would know that there were these controversies about some painting that was sold in London a few years ago, which looked like Jahangir Nama paintings, but they are probably made in Lucknow to imitate Jahangir Nama painting. My feeling is this is also an 18th century Lucknow drawing. Okay, but when you look at something like this, you can imagine that it is something that is made for private pleasure, private viewing. You know, it's doing the work of sexual excitation. And as soon as you see this, I think the difference between this and the formality of the Muhammad Shah painting immediately become obvious. So you can see that that's a painting with another intention altogether, right? So something like that, I don't think has been done in Mughal painting, but at the same time, if we look at the zillions and zillions of Rajput court paintings, which are just so explicitly sexual, right? Why would we not place this in that continuum? That is actually the continuum we need to place it in. When you think about the transferences in the literary sphere, what is the milieu that people are in? Brajbhasha poetry is there. There are a lot of paintings that do speak about, you know, the king's pleasure as a legitimate part of kingship in the Rajput realm, and this seems to be something that picks up from that. But in the rest of Mughal painting, I'm sure there are erotic paintings of the kind, like the drawing that I just showed, but I don't think that there is a formal painting of this kind. Any others?
Yes. Kavita, my question would come back to the fact that we've talked so much about the fact that we do know that he's supposed to be impotent, etc., etc. So that still seems to have stayed in public view regardless of this kind of picture. So after that, then the last part of what you were saying, the conjecture about how this was spread, etc., it wouldn't really have made any difference, right? Because historically, that is what has come down.
But you do also hear of him as being Rangila, right? So that also comes down. And as we see in the world that we inhabit, where there are images at war, there is fake news fighting fake news, no one narrative dominates. But when one narrative comes up and somebody wants to counter it, they inject a narrative of their own, then it's left in the world of circulation for these two narratives to counter each other. And whatever the outcome will be cannot be completely stage managed. So I'm suggesting that this is a strand that is thrown into the swirling mill of gossip, and it does some work. We don't know how much work, what work, for whom, but it does some work just by virtue of having entered that arena of discourses. Annapurna.
I was just wondering if any of these paintings of Muhammad Shah's reign that you've shown and others which you...
I was just wondering if any of the paintings that you've shown from Muhammad Shah's reign and other images you're familiar with, what does it tell? What do they tell us about his attitude towards women in general? Mm-hmm. Because this painting seems to be as much about women and his engagement with women or as himself, if we look at it from that angle. So I was just curious if you had any thoughts about that.
I would be a bit anxious about trying to read the work of a painter as a clue into the patron's mind. I would be a bit cautious about the extent to which images spawn images, so how much of what we see of the composition comes from other compositions and certain formulae. So I don't know if I would be able to read that directly. But to answer your question, I would also need to look at more paintings side by side, like the one of him with the palanquin carried by women is a famous one. But there's the one of him playing Holi. So one could talk about images that depict Muhammad Shah in the company of women and see if one can come up with something, you know, consistent or not in those paintings. But that's some work that would have to be done. I would like to put that in conjunction with a Ragmala series, which I sometimes see attributed to his reign, and sometimes I see attributed to Bikaner from more or less the same time. So I'm not sure, it's in the India Office Library, that Ragmala series. I'm not sure where it belongs, but if that also comes from his reign, then that would be a very interesting cognate. You know, it would be another interesting companion set to look at alongside this painting.
Thank you.
Paruli. I just have a comment to make. You had a very interesting observation that it could be a scene of impregnation.
Yes.
Abul Fazl talks about Akbar as a bridegroom and the entire kingdom as a bride.
Yes.
So I am wondering if this is also an assertion of a sovereign over the geographical kingdom as such, particularly at the time when Nadir Shah was like, you know, invading and...
Right. And that's very nice. Thank you.
And there's another question that I would like to ask. What is the size of the painting? Is it that big that can be like, you know, put up like
a poster? So I'm sorry, I don't know the measurement, but it's like that.
Oh.
It's a large miniature and it's almost square. Which is a problem for me because, you know, a lot of his, the paintings from his period are actually in the Pothi format. And so I was all ready to build a theory about that and Indic forms. But unfortunately, this, unusually for a painting of his time, is not in the Pothi format. It's not in the Codex format. It's square, so it's neither. But it's a large painting. I mean, it's not a painting that you see like this. It's a painting that you see, you know, like that.
Thank you. Thank you.
But thanks for the kingdom, the bride reference. Thank you. I did check that post Nadir Shah's invasion, though I think this painting was pre the invasion, but post Nadir Shah's invasion or post his debility, he did have a daughter. So one child is born post, you know, in the later years. When he's meant to have already started degenerating.
But even before the invasion, the kingdom was crumbling.
Yes.
You had invasions from all over.
Yes. Yes, right in front.
Hello. Would you say that this, by this time, by Muhammad Shah's time, the miniature had also sort of adopted an Indo-Islamic style? Because it seems to be very different from Persian miniatures that influenced the early Mughal paintings of Babarnama, for example. And were there such erotic paintings among the Persian collections, or is this an example of a more erotic Rajasthani style? Or the influence of it?
There are Persian erotic paintings. There are Persian pornographic paintings, there are erotic paintings, they do exist. But there's something to do with the way the body is depicted. No? So when you have extreme stylization, which actually continues in Persian art well into the 17th century, at least to me as a viewer, the depiction of sex in Persian painting is more like an idea. Whereas the fleshly pleasures that you get, even from that drawing that I wasn't supposed to show you that I showed you, it's the way in which the body is fully fleshed out, which actually gives it a charge. You know, the fact that faces are believable. It brings you the memory of touch in a way that a very stylized linear drawing doesn't. Regarding the changing of or the absorption of Persian style and its transmutation, isn't that something that happens very early? I mean, Mughal painting is always changing, but the move away from a very, very Persianate look actually happens in the 1560s.
So much earlier.
Much earlier, yeah.
So,
yes?
The Bikaneri paintings are much later?
The Bikaneri paintings are, they're later even than Muhammad Shah. Yeah. No, they're earlier than Muhammad Shah's reign.
But later than the period itself, later than
which period?
Like Jahangir.
I believe that there is a satirical set which is made by a Mughal artist who enters the Bikaneri employ.
Any more questions? I saw Nilima over here, Nilima Shaikh. Any thoughts?
That's okay. I think it's been a longish afternoon. I think it's been a longish afternoon, Archa. I think we should let people enjoy the afternoon sun.
Well, Kavita, thank you so very much for such a thought-provoking lecture. And it's left us with a lot to think about, particularly because we can't say the word sex or talk about it. And I'm really excited that we could do this and speak about it and discuss things and given the current state of, you know, the nation. But thank you. I'd also like to thank the KNMA team that's been so wonderful. So thank you. And thanks to you all for being such an amazing audience. So look forward to a lot more programming, seeing you. And please do sign up with your emails if you're already not on our email list. So thanks. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.